We'll spend this hour with Yoichi Shimatsu, who is standing by. Dana Durnford is resting tonight. Yoshi is in the States right now, not over in Thailand or Hong Kong or even Japan. So we're glad to have you here, even though here is as discouraging as it gets, because I guess you've been walking the beaches. We have much to talk about this hour. How are you?
Well, you know, we've been expecting this, and
we've been warning people about it for years.
Yeah, I have to say, it's come so quickly, you know, a little faster than I imagined, you know. And what Dana talks about in Vancouver, too bad he's not with us tonight, but the extinction event along the coast that he talks about seems to be affecting Southern California.
Yeah.
I contacted some friends who live sort of further up the coast to see if this is continuous down the West Coast, but my first alert came from a neighbor of one of my relatives who said she had walked along the beach, saw a dead sea lion, saw a dead pup, and then saw a dead sunfish. These sunfish are giant, you know, disc shaped.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they go out pretty far. They're pretty deep. They stay in warm waters. So it's surprising that a sunfish would be far north enough to be knocked out.
I never saw one. I lived on the ocean for almost 10 years. I never saw one.
Yeah, yeah, they're for warmer waters, so it's kind of depressing that the radiation is further south now for sunfish has been had. And then, you know, there's all kinds of speculation about domoic acid, about El Nino.
Oh, please.
Well, I walk along the coast and I find the only shells, okay, that I see. You know, I'm not a real seashell expert. Some are turbans, others are elongated, others are like corkscrews. But kind of a universal wipeout here in south of L.A. I walk for about kilometers, maybe a couple, 2-3 kilometers. Nothing but tide pools. All of them, like, you know, tide pools are usually very organized places. You know, you see these, everything is sort of, they're like pieces of art or living sculpture, right? They're very beautiful places.
Sure.
These are just devastated wreckages. You know, there's bits of seaweed, and the shells are all dead. You know, I look at the oysters, you know, I thought, oh, at least oysters are still alive. I go up to them, and I touch them and they don't close, you know, they're all dead, you know, they're just clinging to the rocks, but they're dead. That's alarming. I found in that, let's say over 4 kilometers of coast, I found 2 abalone, small ones, very small ones, 2 fish, 1 crab, but lots of hermit crabs. And I'm wondering, I've never seen so many hermit crabs in my life because all the shells are dead. You know, the turbine shells are all dead.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They're packed with hermit crab bodies. And I realize the shell, why are hermit crabs, I'm thinking, why are they the major survivors of this wipeout? And I realize, oh, they hide in these shells, and the shells are sort of like armor against radioactivity. They contain calcium, right? The shells make calcium.
Oh, very smart.
And so they're resistant to, so in other words, the calcium will resist strontium because they're very similar chemically. So from that I can deduce, the fact that hermit crabs are alive. They hide in these shells. Now mollusks, of course, won't survive because they're soft tissue, right? But hermit crabs got dual protection.
That's a very good call on your part. Very smart.
Yeah, they got the shell on his back, calcium shell, and then they got their carapace, his armor around them.
Mm-hmm.
So they're more protected than other creatures. They're very opportunistic animals. So basically, I figure out it's supposed to be strontium that's killed everything. Yeah, strontium. Because strontium is, it penetrates your bones, so it's penetrating the shell slowly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So therefore, the hermit crabs have this defense, the calcium act like kind of a shield against the strontium.
Right.
So we have so the strontium's killed everything. Now the algae along the tidal pools are dead. Further out, you have to understand, we've just seen this low tide, right? And it's been this full moon, low tide. So it's a very, very low tide. So I go out to the end of the rocks, you know, where the rocks disappear, basically.
Right.
The tide pools disappear. I can walk out there. I know there's seaweed out there, okay, living seaweed on the rocks.
Uh-huh.
But halfway in, it's all dead. It's gone. Okay, it's broken apart. Then I measure the kelp. The smaller kelp don't have much radiation, but the larger ones, you know, the really big ones that are like several years old, they're like 0.36 microsieverts. So that's pretty high. Those are Fukushima ocean.
That's right.
Let's say it's offshore Fukushima, you know,
yeah,
David.
But yeah.
I measured off, let's say, so, you know, below south of the Fukushima nuclear plant. That's about the levels in the kelp there. So
not good news. Wow.
That's very bad news. So basically, we can assume the kind of destruction that Dana Durnford has been talking about, while it maybe is not as extreme as Vancouver in terms of the, you know, thousands of species knocked out, we have like a significant destruction. And the other really interesting thing I found, I've never seen so many tiny shells. You know, I was thinking of this, I don't know if people remember, he was a really sleazy crooner from Hawaii named Don Ho. And he would sing song to the tourist ladies called Tiny Shells.
Yeah, yeah.
Tiny shells in the water, you know, in Hawaii. You know. And I'm just thinking, I've never seen so many tiny shells. You know, these things would fit easily, you know, like two lengthwise, some of them like maybe about half the length of a penny. Hmm. I took a picture. I'll post something for you later.
Yeah.
Of these shells on a penny, and then just dozens and dozens of little shells, and I'm wondering what happened, you know? Are these things that somehow their growth was retarded, but they didn't grow, because shells grow pretty rapidly. It's very rare to tiny shells. You know, I asked some beachcombers, have you ever seen so many tiny shells before? They said, never. And then the next question I asked these beachcombers, are there less wiggly things in the water? Are there less creatures running around? And they just gave me this depressed look and nodded and walked on.
Uh-huh.
In other words, people are pretty depressed around here. But what's bothersome is people know about it. They know, they probably, you know, some of them know it's radiation, but they don't know what to do. Okay.
No, and the sad thing is there's nothing they can do. It's dead.
And they don't know what to say. They're dumbfounded. You know, And also, they don't want to go against the marine authorities because then it's going to be a challenge, right?
Well, and then you got a little bit of denial mixed in there, too. So,
well, they don't want to face the full brunt of this one. That there's been a massive kill off. There's just a dead whale reported down by somewhere around San Onofre, too. Yeah. Dead whale beaching. I just heard about it. Yeah.
Humpback?
Not clear what. I got to find it. There was just the initial flash of a report that we got here, and then it didn't mention what.
They're due for an obvious increase in mortality, washing up the cabs.
Yeah. But why don't we say, well, there has been an increase in mortality? I know there's no sea lions, you know?
I'm going to read something. Yeah, there are none left.
Darn many sea lions. They're gone. I'm just shocked. In the harbors and all.
Yeah.
These would be real pests in the harbors. They're gone. And then, you know, anyway, when this neighbor tells me about the dead sea lion mother and pup, it's at nighttime. So I said, well, I check the tide chart. Okay, about 3 in the afternoon is low tide. So I go out about 12:30. I walk to a rocky point. Then I see this giant, not giant, but a large earth mover, you know. It's sort of like a bulldozer out there with a dump truck.
Mm-hmm.
And they're sweeping part of the beach. So they're obviously removing bodies. I'm rushing toward them. You know, it's about, easily 500 yards. I'm just rushing. I'm walking as fast as I can toward them. But then they just, by the time I get to them, they're gone. They scoot up the hill and they're gone. In other words, this is like kind of a very, you know, they dart in and dart out. They do these operations.
Huh.
They remove all the larger dead animals.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense. You got it pegged. They don't want this. They don't want this in the news. So they get in and they get out.
It's a cover up. State of California.
Yeah.
The Coastal Commission.
Yeah.
You know, they got a full on cover up going here. Yeah.
I'm telling you, the real estate people aren't happy either. Oh, we lost him. We're getting back. This is unquestionably exactly as he just said, a cover-up. They're removing these bodies as quickly as they can. And I'm telling you, real estate agents are sweating. They know. They know what's going on. There are a number of stories up at Rents that you can read and further explore this. Hopefully you will. It's your planet. You ignore it at your own peril. Dead animals litter California beaches, alarming phenomenon. Another quote, graveyard of washed up sea life. Another one, influx of malnourished sea creatures. The experts are saying, you're back. The experts are saying, we're really starting to worry. The animals are starving to death. They're covered in sores, stunted growth, and have weak immune systems. Absolutely classic radiation sickness symptoms.
No doubt about it, Jeff. And I wish, I'm thinking, instead of all the denial and cover up, there has to be some sort of tactical plan, maybe this thing in the last 5 years, maybe the last 50 years, but we need a plan to save what can be saved, all the species in, places like aquariums,
environmental groups. They have to.
What's the name of that conservancy group?
Nature Conservancy.
Nature Conservancy. They got what? So many hundreds of thousands of acres that are worth $1 billion.
They're loaded.
They got lots of money. I mean, they could be doing something. They own lagoons. They own bays.
They own Santa Cruz Island off Santa Barbara.
They own that. I mean, they could be trying to do not only research, but they can also be building like inland shelters, where we can filter out radio.
Well, where are all these SeaWorld parks? Well, they need to take the lead. They've got the publicity base.
That SeaWorld, they got a huge fan base. It's time for all these marine groups, instead of just kowtowing to some nonsensical people at NOAA or, wherever they're from. The private sector and the NGOs should do their own, radiation prevention program, and marine rescue program. I think, they've got to show what they're worth now. I mean, they don't have to be beholden to the government. Nature Conservancy doesn't need the government. They got plenty on their own.
You bet they do.
They're as rich as the government. They're a government unto themselves. And SeaWorld also, they can outmuscle the government. They got the fan base. They got all the kids with them, right? Teachers with them. It's time these groups step in now. They have
Amen.
To step in.
Yeah.
Otherwise it's really over. I mean, it's going to be like, it's like a windshield wiper. It's done one swipe here. Give it a couple of more swipes. And this window pane is going to be clean. Our windshields are going to be clear of all life form. No more. The insects on the window, on the windshield, right? Pretty soon there aren't going to be any here.
It's spring. I'm not getting any. Very little.
Yeah.
I don't see any birds. Songbirds. No finches. Yeah. No sparrows. No red-winged blackbirds. No meadowlark. Nothing. Right. Nothing.
Yeah. Well, you see, the problem is a lot mountainous, more mountainous up there. British Columbia. There's, it just faces these gigantic mountains. Unfortunately, mountains don't have snow or ice, which we'll discuss. Dana informed me that he went up there.
First time ever, the glaciers are gone.
Glaciers are gone, snow is gone. And in your area, the insects are gone. But down here in the south, we got more like hills. They call them mountains. They're not real mountains.
Oh, I know what you mean,
The sound, the birds, the geese, they're still here. Because they're not so close to the clouds. Also, the desert is more like desert.
Right.
So there's not, but where it's cloudy, where it's mountainous, and you get more precipitation, fog, clouds, that's where the kill-offs are going. The tritium is there. It's killing them.
Please understand, people, this is not going to stop in your lifetime or the lifetime of your great-great-great-grandchildren.
It's over.
The sea is not going to replenish itself. like Dana said, the soup of life. It's not there anymore. The soup is nothing. There's nothing in it. There's no base stock to regenerate the thousands of species that are being eradicated. Already have been eradicated.
Yeah. I mean, it may sound crazy, but like a giant coastal area effort by all the divers here, all the surfers to, let's say, remove the large kelp when they get big because they've bioaccumulated, dry that out somewhere in a safe place and bury it, or put it in some sort of storage containers or into rock in a mountain, and then plant new kelp. Therefore, you have a sort of vacuum system, a bioaccumulation system to suck the radionuclides out of the water. As kelp is so effective?
Kelp
that's
is
one way.
Yeah, it would be an enormous project because the supply of radiation is endless. So it would be a problem.
Yeah, we have to continue doing this maybe for, who knows, decades, centuries. I don't know. But unless we do it, we're going to be on a lifeless continent here.
See, the radionuclides that are being dumped into the ocean have half-lives, some of them, of tens of thousands of years.
They're not going to go away. No. So those we're going to, in other words, but the ones with shorter lifespans, at least you can absorb those, and hopefully the dosages will go down. It'd still be like Russian roulette in the water for anything there.
There you go.
At least if we can reduce the total concentration, that's the best we can achieve. I mean, this is why nuclear energy is so dangerous. Yeah, it's putting like bullets in the water.
It's forever stuff. It just doesn't go away.
And the best we can hope is to reduce the concentration, the intensity of the barrage. That's the best we can achieve. And that will take like dozens, maybe hundreds of years. But somehow to protect the environment from being so radioactive that nothing at all survives.
We can't even clean the damn plastic out of the Pacific. It's the biggest state of Texas, a floating area of plastic refuse. And we can't even do that.
Yeah. Well, that is one giant spot. But then we got all of the chemicals from the plastics, of course.
Oh, yeah.
That leach out of styrofoam, which is in every drop of water.
Phytoestrogens, bioestrogens, you name it.
What have we done, Mike? It hasn't been that long, has it? Yeah. Nuclear power came in the 60s, plastic came in about the same time, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these things haven't been around that long, mm-hmm. 60 years? That was going to be like in 200 years. And it's not going to be 200 years.
Speck.
That's what we got realized.
A fly speck of time.
We talking about when you and I were kids, this stuff came in.
Yeah.
And in one lifetime, we just about finished off the planet,
Five years is one of the major parts of that death knell we've given to the planet.
Yeah.
And all these all these reactors, all nuclear power plants are spewing radiation around the clock into the groundwater, into the air. People, you're dying if you live near a nuclear power plant. Get the hell away. Upwind.
Yeah. And it's tough. It's in the air. They spew the stuff in the air. It escapes as gas. The nuclear waste is not properly disposed of. That's leaking out. A lot of that material, like the low-level waste, gloves, uniform, are being burned, incinerated.
Exactly.
That goes up in the air.
Yeah.
We have so flooded this environment with radiation. There's so many chemicals, so much garbage in our diet that really... And very, very conceivably in one generation. I mean, by the time
you and I
get over, it's basically over. The next generation has no chance.
No chance.
That's just happening in Japan, as everyone knows. It's like, they say, well, Japanese couples don't want to have kids. Japanese women don't want to. They're afraid to have kids.
Right.
Who wants a mutant? I mean, I hate to say it, Your chances of having a mutant are astronomical now. It's ridiculous. Is this going to be the condition all around the world? The Japanese have succeeded in killing themselves off. There's not going to be many left. after look, another generation.
Look at that town, I forgot the name of it, east of Hanford, Washington. The graveyard there. One guy said that I know of graveyards in this town that are full of babies born with no brains.
Jeez.
Empty cranium. No brain.
The nervous system's shut. Yeah, it's gone. Yeah, no development. And I'm afraid that may be the model of what's happening to the marine life, right? Nervous systems, they have very crude circulatory systems. You know, they're not like humans. They don't have well-developed blood vessels, hearts, and all that. So they're just wide open. These soft critters like mollusks or fish, they're just wide open for attack, you know? So they don't have any protection.
They have no chance.
All I can say is I hope you take the hermit crab approach, Jeff. You know.
Well, I'm trying.
Your house with calcium. You know, I mean, you know, with every kind of nuclear buffer you can think of.
I'm doing that. The bio superfood, the Chernobyl product every day.
Take care of your body, but think about your habitation. Learn from that hermit crab.
I was hit heavy. About 2 weeks after when the plants blew, for about 10 days, I don't know what it was. Yeah. I'm guessing iodine, but it was in my sinuses. It was the weirdest sensation, pain back in my throat. It was obvious that I was being hit.
That metallic taste is cesium. Yeah.
So there it is.
Sharp.
I should have cancer by now, but thank God I started taking that, the bio superfood and clean. I was clean to begin with, vegan, and I'm in good shape. I take a lot of supplements, although some people would say you don't need that many. I don't know. I do, and I thank God I'm okay. A lot of people are not okay. They don't feel good. They have chronic fatigue. They don't know what's wrong with them. I'm telling you what's wrong with them. Look at Hanford, for God's sake. Yeah. It's leaking into the Columbia River, folks. You think of Indian Point, it's leaking into the Hudson. What have we done?
The Hudson flows down to either side of New York City. I mean, you know, let's get down from Manhattan. You know, it's New York City. It's in the Hudson River Valley. You know, those are like cliffs on either side. That's where I found at Fukushima. It's most dangerous when you have these very compressed spaces, you know, with radiation. That's where it really builds up. It's really deadly. So along that, there's a little highway to upstate New York along the Hudson. You know, that's just a highway of death for anyone who has to commute that. You know, so, I mean, one thing, they're not teaching people the basics, and the governments there should be spraying down those. I mean, there's got to be things done, you know, to save people's health.
Well, the first thing that the bastards have to do is admit that there's a problem, and they won't do it.
Exactly. Unless you admit there's a problem, how are you going to do anything? And by the time you admit, it's going to be too late. You know?
Amen.
And then a lot of people are saying, gosh, so many people have died of late, you know, so many celebrities have died. Well, why do you think everyone's popping off? You know, they're not taking.
You haven't seen anything yet, folks. Hold on, Yoshi, we got to take a little break here. We'll come right back. Stay tuned. We shall continue. Conversation. It's our weekly report on the Fukushima catastrophe, and you'll be with us for the rest of our lives, as I said, thousands of years, barring some kind of off-planet interference with technology we couldn't dream of. Nothing we can do. There's a story going up tonight, two of them, I want you to take a look at. In the Fukushima radiation section at the very top center column of the news department at Rents, ruined Chernobyl nuclear plant will remain a threat for the next 3,000 years. Horrible. Now, Fukushima is going to remain a threat. In fact, an agent of annihilation, mass extermination and extinction, for maybe tens of thousands of years, barring some kind of technology we can't dream of. The technology needed to repair it, to reclaim it, to salvage it, to shut it down, to cap it, doesn't exist. Another story, Idaho Falls. If you live in Idaho Falls, you better read this story. A darkened central control room with more than 25 computer screens watches over nearly everything occurring inside the radioactive waste treatment plant west upwind of Idaho Falls. The Advanced Mixed Waste Treatment Project. A waste treatment project for radiation. It's a major radioactive waste facility, and there are trouble issues in Idaho Falls. Read the story. I'll put it up later tonight. Talking with Yoshi, as we do nearly every Monday for nearly 5 years now. And the story is not good. You've heard him talk about his walk along the beach. I read a little bit of the material regarding what's happening in California on the beaches. And any of you listening who live on the beaches are probably already seeing this to a degree. I'm going to read just a little bit more here about the story that nobody will talk about. Dead animals litter California beaches, a graveyard of washed-up sea life. The experts say we're really starting to worry. Starting? The animals are starving to death, covered in sores, stunted growth, weak immune systems. They're dying, folks. And they're not just starving to death. They're starving to death because the food chain is destroyed. Here, I'm going to read some quickies. NBC, LA. Officials are investigating why six sea lions are washing up on shore. The Laguna Beach Pacific Marine Mammal Center has an overflow of sea lions. The reason for the influx of sea lions remains a disappointing cold water food source. Wrong. NBC LA, a second story. Now an alarming number of sea lions are washing up along our local beaches. When they say washing up, that's a euphemism for basically they're dead. It is taking longer to rehabilitate these six sea lions. And as most of you can figure out, there's really no way to rehabilitate them because even if you do, they're going to go back into the environment that made them sick and killed so many of them to begin with. Laguna Beach Independent, a newspaper. Most are malnourished and many are infected with parasites. The rehabilitation process is slower this year because the sea lions are coming in far sicker and older than usual. Salon Magazine, Internet. Dead animals litter California beaches. California is in its third straight year of unusual mortality rates for sea lions. The dismal state was first declared January of 2013. Think 311. And death rates have increased each year since, exactly as we told you it would happen. Yoshi, we sadly haven't been wrong about anything.
Well, we've been too right. I mean, you know, and in fact, you know, I've always said that we've tried. People at first accuse us of being alarmists. Now everyone's quiet. All those accusers now are mum, okay? Now, our big mistake is we didn't go far enough. We weren't alarmist enough. You know that. You know we were cautious. It's far worse now.
Well, we tried to be journalists, and
yeah, we tried to just do with what the facts would give us, what we can discern without going overboard. But you know, the situation itself is overboard. I'm on mass extinction. I was down at the Laguna Beach Marine Mammal Center 2 days ago. Yeah, mm-hmm. And. Oh, it's a full house there. I mean, they got pups. The place is packed with pups. You know, it's just astounding. There's just no room to move. You know, they're corralled together. And it's really wonderful to see them, you know, alive. But, you know, they're
what's
supposed
their future?
To be that's the
release, release really back into death.
Back in the wild, but that, yeah. That would be like sending them to sure death. I mean, sending them to the fire, so... You know, this is where I'm saying there's got to be, that's one rescue center. I wish they would be gutsier and just, they know it's radiation. They're not going to say, Now, their guides there are saying that they're all suffering from starvation, from a lack of fish due to warmer waters. And then you just read a report from NBC because of
colder waters. They can't keep their stories straight. No.
It doesn't have nothing to do with that. It has, obviously. I mean, and there's always temperature fluctuations, off the Southern California coast. I mean, these animals can move up and down.
Oh, I'm
coast.
Well aware. Yeah. You bet. Yeah.
There's no problem for them to move up and down the coast in search of food. It's just that you go up and down the coast, there is no food anywhere,
So dead birds on the beach, starved to death. There are no birds left. In fact, Dana last week said he saw about, what did he say, two or three birds per mile that he traveled.
Yeah. We don't see too many dead birds because basically the eggs, they die as hatchlings or they die in the egg. There's just no renewal of birds. And so there's a lot of older birds, but we don't know unless you're an ornithologist, how long the older ones are expected to live, how they fend for themselves, what kind of food they eat and all that. But you just see not too many chicks out there. You just don't see too many, like ducklings. You don't see too many ducklings.
Right.
Occasionally you'll see a mother duck with some ducklings, but they're just not like numerous as before. We never really appreciated, what we had before. Wonderful living world. We just thought we could just, eliminate and bulldoze over, put up parking lots and condos and everything, we took it off the ground, but now we're going to be very alone as a species pretty soon. This is what's scary. It's going to be us and the bacteria, whatever is out there to take
and the cockroaches.
Cockroaches and maybe some predators, some others who are very hardy, have toxic systems, strong immune systems, very immune to...
There'll be some adaptation, like the wild pigs. In Europe and wild boars in Japan.
They're survivors because they can handle toxicity. These animals eat a lot of mushrooms ordinarily. So they develop in kind of...
very good.
Yeah, they're able to urinate out the radiation very quickly. They eat and urinate. Their bodies are used to handling this stuff. That's why they're flourishing. Mm. Well, they're kind of a dangerous species because there's no limit to their growth.
And what predators do they have? None, really.
None. And they can be pretty rough with humans. The humans are very rough with them. Throw firecrackers at them. Shoot them. So they have no love for humans. And they'll eat a human, too.
They may be running around in small packs, predatory packs here at some point. Who knows?
And they get large. They get very, very large. They have memories. They remember how abusive humans were to them.
I was thinking about
I really like wild boar. They're actually very gentle, nice creatures, but humans have done horrible things to them.
Look what we've done to whales. Same thing. I was thinking about what you said the other day. There's some geese, Canada geese here, and they're the smallest number of hatched babies in 5 years. I think I counted 10. They're usually 20, 30, sometimes over 30.
How long do those are survive is a real question, because they're more vulnerable. Their cells are dividing. Why do the young ones die out? It's because of cell division. That's when radiation really messes up your chromosomes. When the chromosomes divide, the DNA splits apart. Splits apart. That's when radiation just will break those strands, cause a mutation. It will lead to death because, it will work. They'll basically knock out vital parts of your DNA. So that's why we see older animals about, but the young ones just don't make it. And what this means for humans, we're seeing in Japan. The population has shrunk by a million.
You mentioned ducks. I've seen maybe three ducks this year, usually 10, 20. They're insect eaters. Remember that. They eat insects. Canada geese eat grass.
The other problem, they eat a lot of water plants, and there's a lot of radioactivity in those water plants. And then you usually see every spring, right? Like at this time of year, you see a mother duck leading a bunch of, ducklings.
You? Oh, yeah. 10, 12 sometimes.
Yeah, we're not seeing that. We're just not seeing that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when, how far that comes down the food chain is going to be a good question. When, you know, you're not going to have eggs for breakfast anymore. If you notice worldwide, the price of eggs is going up. Yeah. You wonder why. Yeah, is it because of radiation? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The eggs fail to mature. Chickens, their ovaries are under attack. It's a worldwide phenomenon. Price of eggs is going up. And over the scarcity of eggs. This is so extensive, yeah. The damage to life.
It's so extensive on life,
on other life forms.
The chain is not something that's readily visible as being big links. Oh, you got 20, 30 links. It goes in many directions, this chain. It's got many tentacles, tendrils that branch off. Look, what's beginning to manifest now is what we told you about nearly 5 years ago. And you're going to live to see the government forced to admit that the planet is in decline. It may not go much further than that, but you're going to see the death of the Pacific Ocean acknowledged and become an accepted fact by a lot of people. And if any of you folks out there are new to this program, do not even dream about eating anything out of the Pacific Ocean. There's not much left to eat. 97% of the bluefin tuna are gone. You know what they're calling it, Yoshi? Overfishing.
Overfishing. Yeah, that just can't be. Yeah, because there's not a lot of fishing left of those. I mean, most of them farm-raised, and a lot of farm-raised ones are just so wiped out now, you know, by diseases.
Well, they feed those crap anyhow,
The fishing industry's collapsed all over the place. Okay, it's just, you know, it's just, we got to recognize that. It's collapsing all over the place. So, you know, this is, and these are with fishing controls. You know, we've had a fairly strict regime of fishing controls. There's, you know, a lot of effort against pirate fishermen and all that, you know, the rogue fishermen.
Right.
So it's not like we're not doing anything against, you know, overfishing. It's just that populations are collapsing. And what we talked about earlier, I described to you on that first trip I took to the shore, east of Tokyo, where the two currents mixed to form the North Pacific Current, saw the dead mollusks and all that.
Uh-huh.
I pointed out this, if you know, out to sea where I look from that point is where it begins, all the spawning, you know, the huge whirlpools, a very nutrient-rich cold water, warm water to nurture the plankton and the, that this is where the spawning occurs, all the young, you know, the young fish develop. This is where all the feed develops, and this goes across, feeds into the North Pacific Current, and then this is what feeds the salmon and the herring and the sardines. You know, all your fish, you know, the marlins, whatever. They're all living off this vast food factories off the coast of Japan. Yeah,
it's being transported over here in the North Pacific Current of death. Yeah.
And we're not seeing a lot of life coming across, right?
No.
All we're seeing is death, you know, coming in dead waters. So it means the Pacific has been effectively, life has been killed from the coast of Japan to the coast of North America. And then that's been marching down the coast, the west coast, past Washington, Oregon, California, into Mexico. And what we're seeing this year is really extinction, mass extinction event. When the only shellfish alive that I see are a couple of tiny abalone. Yeah, that's it. I mean, this is amazing, right? I mean, one crab. This is just crazy. You know, it's never been like this. No one ever seen anemones, those beautiful, beautiful creatures like
that. If they had made a movie about this 10, 15 years ago, people would have been...
No one
would
believe.
No, they would have just said, nah, can't happen.
No, can't happen. Well, it is
science fiction.
It's happening here. And this is something, you know, we got to confront these guys at University of Victoria and all that. And you know, Woods Hole, get off of Dana's back. Dana's been proven right, you know. Dana's absolutely right. And he has every right to be angry, you know, with these guys. They have no right to tell bald-faced lies to the public that everything is okay histamolic acid. You know, there's not much radiation in the water. I have no right to say these things. Absolutely no right. And, you know, the extinction of life on Earth, well, you know, that is something to fight for. I can't, you know, I mean, Dana's right, you know?
He's 1,000% right. They should drop those charges right now, for God's sake.
What are we supposed to do when we face mass extinction event of life on Earth? Are we just supposed to sit there like a bunch of dumb monkeys and pretend like nothing's happening except this is something that fate brought us? Is not human responsibility? Or are we supposed to go after the people who caused this? You know, people attempt to Tokyo Electric Power who've gotten away with everything. Yeah. They got tons of money. They have billions of dollars in Canada. They own the largest uranium mine in Canada. Do you think we should forgive these people? Let them go? Buy their stock shares? Or should they be punished? I mean, severely punished for what they've done. And this thing going in Japan, died of radiation, that's absolute total crap. Milwaukee City, I made a new video about this. I talk about how Community of 2000 disappeared when the tsunami were lost, but they weren't reported. They were near a nuclear waste dumping ground. Another place, thousands died because of some major accident, a nuclear accident north of Fukushima. Radiation killed thousands of Japanese, and we should go after the people who say no one died because of radiation. I mean, they should be severely punished.
I don't know any punishment that would be good enough for them.
That's what I'm saying. I think Dana is right. Ultimate punishment for those who, you know, allow this stuff to happen and perpetrated this and continue to perpetrate this.
Well, they're accessories to mass murder. Yoshi, come on. They are accessories to mass murder.
Mass murder. Killing humans is one thing. Destroying the entire all life on Earth. I don't know. I can't think of a higher crime than that. You know, we're killing thousands of other species too. You know, I mean, if humans want to kill themselves, that's one thing. But you know, that's suicide. But if we you know, who gave us the right to go out and kill thousands of species? You know, I don't see that in the U.S. Constitution. Do you? You know, we declared the right of every human being to go out and murder 1,000 species. That's not a protected right. That's not a privilege. You know. It's a criminal offense of the worst sort. So I really hope that people in Canada see the light here and realize Dana is absolutely right to get angry. You know, someone's got to get angry.
Somebody's got to do it. You know, another thing, he's actually, because of his heroic, selfless work, he's taken future pressure off these people, these liars. He's done the work for them. So later on, they don't have to be so accountable, do they? Because he's already put the stuff out there. They just got to drop this crap and leave him alone, for God's sake. He deserves the highest medal of freedom we can give to somebody.
Exactly. The Canadian government owes him a medal. And they should shut down their uranium mines before all of Canada is gone. Yeah. I mean, he's done a service to his country. He's done a service to North America, to humanity, and to every living species out there in the Pacific Ocean. You know, I mean, and it's not just the Pacific. You know, I don't know if you noticed, tonight's a very cold night. Is it cold up where you are?
It was cold last night. It got down to, there was snow in the surrounding mountains. It got down into the upper 30s, 36, 35, 37. Very cold all of a sudden.
Yeah. And isn't that funny? That just timed after Tokyo Electric Power says it's going to release all the tritium.
Oh, they did. That's right.
That's right. You know, the tritium, they released that stuff. It's highly volatile, very active.
Yeah.
It's radioactive, gets into the atmosphere, gets into the clouds, goes to the North Pole, cracks apart the ice. That's what's destroying all the glaciers in Canada now and wiping out all the snow fields. Ice crystals don't know. And when you destroy ice, what you've done is you create enormous volatility. The cold, instead of staying on the ground, right?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of staying in the ice, it's released. And that's why we're down this cold. You know? It's just perfectly timed with the Tokyo Electric say, we're going to open, you know, we're going to unloose the tritium. We're going to dump into the Pacific.
Yeah,
and
who's still
the United government, the Canadian government, to anybody say, you know, you're not going to release tritium, you know, into waters that are coming to our shore.
They haven't even said anything about the dam. How about the incineration that doesn't slow down?
Yeah, in Tokyo. Yeah, there's very stuff in Tokyo where the Olympics are going to be held with radioactive isotopes.
Mm-hmm.
Radioactive isotopes, yeah.
Yeah.
In a very gasified form, yeah. Gasified form.
They've been burning that for over 4 years, folks, and it goes into the air. A lot of it gets picked up and brought over here. A lot of it comes back down on them. I mean, it's suicide. It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's nothing. Can you think of one intelligent thing anyone's really done about this disaster?
The reaction is like, can we think of the worst possible thing to do to make Fukushima worse, to make it global?
That's right. That's exactly right.
Unfiltered. In other words, when they put in a plasma furnace, you can't filter it out. It becomes an ionized gas.
That's my point. Yeah. It's just beyond belief. Anyway, our good thoughts, as we've said, and I hope all of yours go to Dana. I hope they drop these charges against him for simply doing the job that needs to be done. And that's all he did. He cares about this planet. He cares about the countless species that have been lost. And many will never be seen again. Ever. Ever, ever.
Well,
we're on the doorstep of a massive extinction event here. And it's unfolding right before your eyes. No joke.
Yeah,
no exaggeration.
This is the problem. We've got to come up with to defend or protect what we can still do. You know, I think there's a lot of those species, you're right, are not coming back. A lot of them are localized.
Yeah.
There's a lot of subspecies. Probably tens of thousands of
subspecies. They're gone. Never even cataloged. Don't even know.
Yeah. Yeah. We're in the midst of the greatest tragedy for life on Earth. You know, I mean, this is probably greater. I've always said that. I think this is greater than what happened in the Ice Age. Yeah, this is, you know.
I won't argue that. Not for one second. I totally agree. Yeah.
And it's totally a human responsibility, totally a policy decision. And governments could have done something, should have done something. The international bodies like the IAEA, the Watchdog Agency, they just got a couple $1 million from the Japanese government. You know, there's a $31 million grant from the Japanese government, the IAEA. It's a bribe, basically, to build
labs. That's all it is.
Yeah, hey, scientists there, just pay off. They're just payoff after payoff to the scientists.
Everybody's got a price.
Those scientists are doing nothing. Those scientists are doing nothing to stop this crisis. Quite the other. They're looking the other way, doing meaningless, absolutely meaningless work, which will have zero effect, zero good is going to come out of it, because there ain't nothing, there's going to be anything left to protect.
Nothing.
Our civilization is going to be gone.
Yeah.
This is.
Yoshi.
To think that our civilization can survive without biology, without the whole biosphere, that is.
That's absurd.
Total
stupidity. Yoshi, thank you. Talk to you next week. I think we've summed it up as well as we can do. And that's all the truth, folks. There's no exaggeration, no hyperbole. Thank you for that, as always, my friend. You take care.
Dana, if you're out there, we hope to hear from you soon. Yeah, good luck to you.
All right. Night.
Okay, good night.
Okay. Okay, and good night to all of you. And those of you tomorrow who have an opportunity to vote, please do so. And hopefully we're all in agreement what needs to be done here. Ted Cruz is not an outsider. Give me a break. Thanks for being here. Talk tomorrow.